Three, two, one, and we're live. Welcome once again to HeroQuest fans. Welcome back. It's been a while. With the holidays coming up, I haven't been able to stream as often as I would like. And actually, today is one of those days where I was waiting for some deliveries of some things to talk about, and it didn't quite turn out right, and so I'm still waiting on those things. So I'll have to talk about them on a future stream, but that's okay. So the idea was that I was going to start printing out some more cards again. What I did in the past was I actually had my homebrew cards professionally printed, which is an extravagance. It's a luxury. But I do like the way that they turned out. And it took a while. And I expect these will take a while as well. But I'm basically taking my homebrew stuff and I'm porting it to the format of the remake from 2021. So the new cards in the new remake set from Hasbro are approximately poker size. So I believe that's 2.5 by 3.5. So it's a little wider. And it's got like a linen type finish. Hopefully my it's kind of dry in here, so I may be taking some swigs from the old sweet tea here. Cheers to Dead Gamer. And also, because it's winter time, you know, they got the heat going, so the systems may, well, hopefully they won't overheat. I've got this low budget setup, but anyway, yeah. So I'm basically making remake size style cards for my homebrew stuff, and I'm also making classic style cards of the remake extras, of which there were a few, just for my personal use, you know, at my gaming table. So just having fun. But anyway, today I had some other things to talk about. I actually have a lot of topics. So thanks to Shadzar. I was talking to him in the Twitch discussion and then also in our new Discord channel, because we have a Discord channel for HeroQuest fans. And that link, actually, I need to link it. So I'll be linking that soon. But yeah, feel free to join the Discord and have a conversation. But anyway, yeah, I was talking with him and we were talking about some different things regarding the rule book that I just read off in a recent video about the Japanese version. So the Japanese version of HeroQuest, as you know, is from 1991. And over the last several years, several fans on Ye Olde Inn and other places, I think actually an Old Scratches forum as well, actually started there, so credit to them. I think I forgot to mention that in the last stream. Anyway, they had started translating the text into English. And for a lot of it, they had to use Google Translate, so it wasn't exact, and there's some editorial decisions here and there. And some people decided to actually convert it to the North American rule set, but Hispazargon's goal was to just try to make a literal, fairly literal, but readable translation. So I read this last time. And anyway, there's other components besides this. This is just a fan printout of the rule book, the rules of play. But there's also the quest book, and that's what I have here. And obviously this is just a fan-made translation. So I was going to go through this without spoiling everything, but just kind of give you a sense of what it's like. Because really what it is, the short version is, the Japanese version is the game system, so 14 quests, and they're pretty much brand new. I mean, yes, there are a few that are clearly inspired by the European and North American versions, but you're playing it with a whole different rule set. So even though it uses the same assets as the other versions of HeroQuest, and that's the cool thing, you can take your version of HeroQuest and play this version. The only thing is you're going to be missing a few cards, is really all it is. Now the cards are actually still being translated, so I don't have all those with me, but I do want to just kind of give you a preview of that. So as you know, there's quite a few differences in this version. A lot of it is just substitutions. So we've got the warrior. Let's take the cover off there. You got the warrior and the magician instead of the barbarian and the wizard. You got mono lizards instead of fimmers. You've got dark warriors instead of chaos warriors. You've got an evil god or false god instead of the chaos warlock there. And it's kind of interesting because you can see some ties in with the Warhammer fantasy world. The bad guy you're fighting is, well, I'll get to that. I'll get to that soon enough. But yeah, so As you can see, there's a lot of stuff on my screen here. It's all kind of jumbled up, but what I've got right there in the upper left corner is the warrior. And this, of course, is a translation. So you can see that the character board there is very similar to the European board. So the North American version, a lot of people are familiar with, was nice, this nice little square tile. This is more of a rectangle. But warrior, you are a strong and skilled fighter. You have the endurance to be in the forefront of battle. So we still got three attack dice for combat, two defend dice when he's defending, and he's still got his two movement dice, eight body points and two mind points. So everything's the same there. But when he starts to level up, so in quest four and on, you can level up. So that's page 18 of the rules of play. After each quest, you may attempt to level up by paying 500 gold. If you level up, your max body point increases by one. Roll four combat dice. If you roll two or more white shields, you level up. So that's a completely new mechanic in the Japanese version. And the Japanese version was explicitly marketed as an RPG, a role-playing game, whereas the other versions of HeroQuest is always a board game, fantasy adventure game, that sort of thing. So they put this mechanic in there. And they tried to make the characters a little different from one another. So if my system cooperates, I'm going to show you. This is just a PDF. And if this is not the final version either, and I didn't translate this. So you got the warrior, you've got the dwarf. Let me make sure that's lined up. You are small in stature, but good in combat. Your skill allows you to disarm traps. So he's got the same stats as before, seven body, three mind, two combat dice. Now notice it's not giving you a starting weapon. That was something from the North American version. Whereas the other versions, they just say, okay, wizard's got one, elf and dwarf have two, and then the barbarian has three. Whereas the North American version, they explicitly said, okay, the barbarian or the warrior has a broadsword, which attacks with three. And so what that mechanic allowed you to do is, in the North American version, as you got better weapons, you could sell your starting gear to get some of your gold back. Anyway, the dwarf disarm traps to be used from quest 4. Details on page 16 of the rules of play. So you can refer back to my other video where I talked about those things. The dwarf has the ability to disable traps while moving. Each time the dwarf moves, he can disable one trap. Level up to be used from quest 4. Details on page 18 of the rules of play. After each quest, you may attempt to level up by paying 500 gold. If you level up, your max body point increases by one. Roll four combat dice. If you roll two or more white shields, you level up. So let's see, was that the same? Four combat dice, two or more. Yep, so the warrior and the dwarf have the same level up mechanic. Now we get to the elf. Now here's where it starts to get interesting, I think. Oops. Let's get that lined up. Okay. Oh. Sorry, I've got too many screens going here. Come on. Does that look better? Yes, it does. Okay. So the elf, you are a fairly skilled fighter with some magical ability. You can use a bow to attack distant enemies. So check that out. So the ranged weapon, the crossbow, can only be used by the elf in this version. So that does give him a little bit of a difference. Now he's got the same stats, six body, four mind, two combat dice starting attack. Oops, let me just adjust that slightly. There we go. Okay, beginner magic. See page 11 of the rules of play. During the first three quests, the elf cannot cast any spells. Intermediate magic. See page 12 of the rules of play. You can only cast one of the following spells per quest during quests 4 through 8. First example is healing. May be cast on yourself or an ally. Roll four combat dice. For each white shield rolled, the hero recovers one body point. Okay. Holy Flame may be cast to attack one enemy. Roll two combat dice. Each rolled skull counts as a hit, but the monster can defend by rolling a number of dice equal to its mind points. Intermediate spells can be cast any number of times. So right there, you can use your magic as much as you want. So he either gets healing or Holy Flame. And Holy Flame, as I mentioned in the other video, is a cool ability. It is exactly the, it functions exactly the same as the darkness spell Arrows of the Night from the Wizards of Morcar European expansion. And healing is completely unique. I don't think it appears in any other version of HeroQuest. But the fact that you can keep trying to heal yourself is pretty neat. Now, in the Japanese version, I don't believe there's any mechanic that says that if you die, you can save yourself from dying by using an unused healing spell. But the fact that you can just heal infinitely means that every turn you could try and just keep trying to heal yourself or heal another person. And the rules are a little vague on the intermediate beginner magic going away once you switch to advanced. I mean, I assume that's what they meant, that each successive stage of magic replaces the previous one. Because if it didn't, you'd basically have an ability to just heal yourself infinitely. But anyway, advanced magic, see page 19 of the rules of play. Now here it's going to be familiar to other HeroQuest versions. From quest 9 and after, the elf may choose one of the four magic elements, spell dex. Each spell may only be cast once per quest, so there you go. Level up, to be used from quest 4, details on page 18 of the rules of play. After each quest, you may attempt to level up by paying 500 gold. If you level up, your max body point increases by 1. Roll 3 combat dice, so 1 less. If you roll 2 or more white shields, you level up. So as you can see, at the end of the campaign, in theory, the heroes could have much above their maximum body points. Or they might not, depending on their luck. The random roll of the dice. Okay, and then last but not least, we've got the Magician filling in for the Wizard in this version. Magician, you can use a number of magic, such as attack, defense, and recovery. Get straightened out there. Magic is powerful, but you have no physical strength, so you're not good in combat. That's pretty severe, but his stats are the same. 4 body, 6 mind, 1 attack die to start with. Beginner magic, see page 11 of the rules of play. You can cast the following spell during quests 1 through 3. First aid. May be cast on yourself or an ally. He recovers 1 body point. Beginner spell can be cast any number of times. So that's about your weakest baseline method of healing. It's 1, so he could just, every turn, just heal 1, heal 1, heal 1, heal 1, until he's back to normal. Intermediate magic, see page 12 of the rules of play. You can cast the following spells during quests 4 through 8. This is familiar, healing again, and Holy Flame. Now, notice that he gets to use both, whereas the elf had to choose one, healing or Holy Flame, whereas he can use both, and they function the same way in his hands. Intermediate spells can be cast any number of times. Advanced magic, see page 19 of the rules of play. So from quest 9 and after, that's when things get tough. Once I show you the quest, you'll see that, gee, there's hardly any monsters in the first few quests, but things ramp up in difficulty. Okay, so from quest 9 and after, the magician may take the remaining 3 magic elements spell card decks left by the elf. So notice the elf gets to choose first, as opposed to the other versions where the wizard chooses first, then the elf, then the wizard takes everything else. So each spell may only be cast once per quest. And like I said, the other cards are still being translated, so any unique features or variations from the European and North American versions would be noted once we get those and can look at them up close and personal. After each quest, you may attempt to level up by paying 500 gold. If you level up, your max body point increases by 1. Roll 3 combat dice. If you roll 2 or more white shields, you level up. So actually, the elf and the wizard have the same ability to level up, according to this translation. And these are just the credits here from Hispazargon. And special thanks to the people who worked on it from 2012, actually, from the Japanese version. So anyway, yeah, interesting stuff. So let's just switch over to my other camera here. Okay, so sorry about that camera glitch there. So you should be able to see now my messy table of stuff. This is just the Campaigner. This was a magazine. This is not a paid endorsement, of course. HeroQuest, the legend turns 25. So they just had this because the 25th anniversary, and there was going to be this Game Zone remake of HeroQuest. This is before the official remake from Hasbro. There's all this wrangling about the who owned the copyright and trademark and everything. But they had the reprints of this magazine, and I ordered it a long time ago, and I completely forgot about it. And this is actually from 2014. And they guess they lost my order and all the madness. And so they sent me a new one. They said, oh, well, we'll send you a new one. And I forgot about it again. And then it finally arrived, and I was like, oh, cool. There's all these neat little articles, and, you know, it's really nostalgic and nerdy and whatever. It's just talking about reminiscing about what it was like to be a HeroQuest fan back in the day and just kind of going back over it. Not assuming that you still have your set, but, you know, just some fun little things. So I thought that would be a fun thing to pick up. And I actually haven't read through it yet. I've just kind of skimmed. But yeah, they even talk about the PC game, which if you're familiar with my YouTube channel, this is one of the first videos I posted having to do with HeroQuest of the PC game, which of course I do own. So good stuff. So yeah, I might review this at some point, but probably not. I'll probably just read it for fun. Anyway, it's called The Campaigner. This was issue 9, if you were curious. Kind of expensive, but it's a specialty magazine. So yeah, The Campaigner. All right, so let's go to our close-up camera. There we go. Actually, let me get you a better view of the artwork. It looks like a painting. So my camera is frozen. Oops. Sorry, folks, technical difficulties here. Yeah, I think we'll just end up using this here. Oh, there we are. Yeah, sometimes this happens. Okay, there, might as well just get rid of the camera that was dead there. Let's throw that down there, throw that there, throw that there just for fun. Okay, so what we've got here now, of course, the Japanese rules of play, like I was talking about. But what I wanted to look at now is what's called the quest book. So this is the Japanese rules quest book. It's obviously printed. I'm just going to go through some of it, not the entire thing, because I don't want to spoil it for you. If you're interested in playing this, then I encourage you to go over to Ye Olde In forums and check out his Bazargon and Japanese quest book translation. Warning, this quest book can only be read by the Demon King. That's what they call Zargon or Morcar in this version. The evil wizard player is the Demon King, or the King of the Demons. No one other than the Demon King should open this book. Well, since I play as Zargon, I'm going to go ahead and open it. So, spoilers. Last chance. All right, so there's the first quest. So, just pretend you didn't see that there. I'm just going to go ahead and read. Chapter 1, The Departure. Quest 1, Test of Strength. There are 3 ancestral treasures on Neef Island. Yes, this takes place on Neef Island, so Japan. Fantasy version of Japan, so like that. There's the little map. Actually, that's upside down, sorry. There are 3 ancestral treasures on Neef Island. These treasures have been stolen. This appears to be the work of a group of monsters that have recently been on a rampage on the island, led by a mono lizard named Virag. Go to their lair in the foothills of Fuji Volcano. Defeat their leader Virag and bring back the 3 treasures. If you succeed in this quest, then you will be awarded 50 gold each, regardless of how you performed. Heroes, work together to complete this quest. And it bears Mentor's seal there, as usual. And you can see it's done in the black and white style of the European version, similar to that. And If you look closely, you can see actually the I have the autofocus, the icons of the orc and the goblin are slightly different. The eyes are different. So not a lot of changes there, but kind of the same basic idea. Much easier than the trial. The next quest is, I'll just read off the titles because I don't want to give you too much spoilers this time. Quest 2 is Digo's Fort. Quest 3 is Fortress of Pain. And so now we're into Chapter 2, The Mission. Quest 4 is Ruins of Wei. Quest 5, Dread Castle. Now, this is before the Hasbro remake where they switched Chaos to Dread, so you could call it Chaos Castle, but it was actually Dread Castle in the original. And as the plot unfolds, you're actually trying to stop the revival of this evil god character. So who is he? Well, it seems to be this version's interpretation of the Witch Lord, but they call him the evil god or the false god. So what some people did, I think Bastion Bucks did this before he retired his North American conversion, is he just said, fine, it's one of the chaos gods from Warhammer Fantasy Battle, which of course, as lore fans know, HeroQuest is loosely based on the same universe as Warhammer Fantasy from Games Workshop, which of course they toned down and removed that from excuse me, the new version, because they're not working with Games Workshop in the remake. I just need a little swig of tea here. But yeah, Dread Castle. Now things are starting to heat up. They're getting more monsters, more traps. Because actually, when we think about we think about the quests in the original version, in the European version, you had the maze as the first quest, and that was the heroes are not working together. They're just trying to see who can get out of the maze first and get the gold reward. And there's just a few orcs and nothing much else. I don't even think there's any furniture. It's just doors, orcs, and heroes just running around. In the European version of the trial, they say only the monster cards are used, which implies you're not searching for anything, you're not using any magic either. Whereas the North American version of the trial, you use everything, and you're going to need everything because it's a super hard quest. Well, the quests in this Japanese version are fairly easy in comparison. There's like one or two that are fairly challenging. Excuse me. Yeah, it's dry air. But it could be interesting. And then I've actually played the first four quests using the North American rules, and it's a good introduction for new players because it kind of slowly ramps up the difficulty instead of throwing the kitchen sink at you like the US version that we grew up playing. So that was Quest 5, Dread Castle. Excuse me. I apologize, folks. I'm actually going to be doing an interview with Lee at Covert Nerd tomorrow, so got to get my voice back. He runs a really cool nostalgic podcast that he invited some folks to be part of with the to celebrate the remake of HeroQuest. But I actually didn't realize his first episode was dealing with HeroQuest, so Covert Nerd, and that's how we started it off, episode one, several years back. So it's pretty neat. And I didn't realize that he actually knew Dwayne Agin. So Agin's Inn was the first big, well, not the very first, but the first big HeroQuest fan forum that I knew about. So Old Scratch's forum was pretty popular as well. So this is way before social media, before these Facebook groups and Twitter and all that took off. So it was Dwayne Agin's Inn, and he turned it all over to some different people who put up Ye Olde Inn. So I think actually I misspoke in the interview because I was talking about Ye Olde Inn, Ye Olde Inn, but it was really Dwayne Agin's or just Agin's Inn back in the day. Now the new site basically copied everything and it was more or less identical to what he had. But I actually went back in the history and I saw how they were uploading things and how it was developing. And so I had printed out some stuff from the old days. So it was about 2002 we went back and we were digging up HeroQuest and looking around on the internet to see, well, what kind of fan stuff exists for this? And sure enough, it was Agen's Inn on all the printouts, because I'd printed out pages and stuff. I hadn't participated in the forums. So it's kind of neat to kind of revisit that. And memory is a funny thing, but yeah. So now it's Ye Olde Inn. But credit where credit is due, Agen's Inn back in the day, and I didn't realize that Covert Nerd had talked about that, so he knows his stuff, so good for him. Anyway, yeah, so Quest 6 is the ghost ship in the Japanese version. Let me just check something real quick here. See if we've got anybody in the chat yet. Nope, we don't. That's okay. I was a little late getting started, so not a big deal. Most of the stuff I figure people see it on the replay anyway. Okay, Quest 7, Trial of the White Mountain. So now things are picking up. So you can see a lot more monsters now. Yeah, I think this is the one where they separate everybody, and it's a grueling battle. Now, the Japanese version does adopt the European mechanic of having most of the monsters only have one body point, but actually, it's interesting because I think it's the Chaos Warrior and the Gargoyle, and possibly the Fimmer too. I can't remember, but yeah, a few of the monsters have two body points. And you actually have to do two damage in a round to kill them. So if you just do one damage in your attack, they heal that other body point the next time. So I guess you'd have to just do two or more hits of damage to actually kill them. So it's an interesting way to work that out. Quest 8, Curse of Darkness. So, and again, these quests mostly have totally new gimmicks. And they have no equivalent in the other versions. So it's like having 14 brand new official quests, which is pretty awesome. There is a quest where you teleport around. Like when you go through the door, you got to roll and you teleport through. Let's see, what was that called from the original? The Castle of Mystery, that's what it was called. So there's a quest that's similar to that. And the first quest is kind of sort of similar to the trial a little bit. And there is a quest where you have to rescue a princess and escort her to safety, so it's kind of like the rescue of Sir Ragnar. But in general, they're all brand new stuff. So we've got Chapter 3, The Search, Quest 9, Spirit Valley. I think in some of the other translations they called it Spirits Valley, Valley of Spirits, but they mean spirit like strength, like courage, that kind of thing. Those who have spirit. Quest 10, Magician of Fire. Well, that sounds like the Fire Mage, doesn't it? And it's actually Balor, so there's another quasi-equivalent quest there. Then we've got Quest 11, Balor's Struggle. I think in Bastion Bucks's interpretation, he called it Burrow instead of Balor. So it was Burrow's Resistance. Here's Balor's Struggle. And you could see that there's some guesswork involved in the interpretation, but I think most fans are thinking now that Balor is probably what was intended, that they reused a lot of the names from the original version and just give them new roles and things. Quest 12 is Mystery of Star Lake. Yeah, this is the one that's like Castle Mystery. So just a quick glance. See? There's all those rooms that you teleport back and forth to. And through the course of these quests, you're actually trying to acquire these artifacts, which are unique to the Japanese version. There's a freeze bow, or frost bow, or ice bow, depending on how you translate it. There's a silver blade or silver sword, and there's a flame axe or fire axe. And so you're trying to acquire these to fight the evil god because there's a certain order that you use those weapons to damage him. So it's kind of a neat way of doing it. So instead of having a single weapon like the Spirit Blade to kill the Witch Lord, it's you have to acquire these groups of weapons. And it's a neat way to do it because then you're trying to make sure all the heroes stay together and survive so that they can all use their abilities. Because the game kind of gives you hints as you go, like, okay, this is what you need these for. This is what you're gonna do to fight the final bad guy. So, and I like the kind of wintry ice kind of themes. It reminds me of the Barbarian Quest pack, which actually came out in '92, so it hadn't been out yet. So I'm curious whether the Japanese design team knew about all these other things and kind of incorporated those ideas in, or if they just kind of started from scratch. But it seems like they came up with some similar things, so I'm sure they had feedback from their counterparts in other countries or access to those other things. Because there was no Keller's Keep, no Return of the Witch Lord for Japan. It was just the game system, or just HeroQuest. So Quest 13, Temple of Ice. And then final chapter, the showdown. This is Quest 14, the final battle. So you return to the Dread Castle. So instead of Barrack Tor in the original, it's the Dread Castle. And it sounds as if you're trying to defeat Grimdead himself. So it's like the final battle with Zargon. And you'll notice on this map, it actually says the Kingdom of Grimdead, which is pretty neat. So it's like you're actually marching on Zargon's fortress. Like this could be it. But are you really gonna wipe out the evil wizard? Is this really the end of HeroQuest permanently? I don't think so. You and I know better, right? The bad guy always gets away, and there's always a chance for a new adventure. Because sure enough, when you get to the end, you're actually gonna have a blank quest map to make your own adventures. So, and I'm pretty sure that's, yeah, it's right here. See? So the quest never ends. As long as you have the imagination and the time, it's gonna keep going. So, yep, that's that. All right, and so then at the end there is a, I guess in Dungeons and Dragons they call this a bestiary. So a list of monsters. So I'm gonna read this off. And this is great because even though you don't have the cards yet, because there are monster cards, of course, this gives you all the stats. So you'll notice something. Each monster has a reward or bounty for him. So that means every monster you kill in the course of the game gives you a gold reward. So that's a unique feature of this version because there's only one quest. I think it's called Bastion of Chaos in the original, where you got bounties for killing monsters. Whereas here it's like every monster. Now you don't get to kill wandering monsters. Let's move this out of the way. They just attack you with an unblockable attack and then disappear in the Japanese version. But anyway, Goblin, a small and cool green monster. It's small, but it will try to hurt you. So it's got 10 squares of movement, 2 attack, 1 defense, 1 body point, 1 mind point. So same as always. Its reward is only 5 gold. So that makes sense. And these gold values are different than Bastion of Chaos in the North American version. So, but yeah, the amount of gold you'll have by the end is huge. Like you'll have, I don't know, it's like maybe 3 to 6 times more gold than you would get in the other versions. But you're going to need that gold because you're going to try to use it to level up. Plus, you remember the mechanic where if your character dies the first time, he can come back one time, but he loses all the gold that he has because they revive him at the temple. So there's that. So there's opportunities to be divested of your gold. Okay, orc. Orcs are the same kind of monsters as goblins. However, they are larger and more powerful than a goblin. So once again, 8 movement, 3 combat dice attack, 2 combat dice defense, 1 body point, 2 mind point. So really that's the same as the other versions, but you get 20 gold for killing an orc. Mono lizard. So this would be the Fimmer, and then in the remake it would be called the Abomination. But yeah, mono lizard, one eye. It's kind of a cool thing. A lizard-like monster, stronger even than an orc. Mono lizards often have orcs and goblins under their control. So we got movement, 6 squares, three attack dice, 3 defense dice, 1 body point. Okay, so I was wrong. I misspoke earlier. They only have 1 body point in this version, just like the European version. North American version, they'd have 2. 3 mind points, and you get 30 gold for killing a mono lizard. Then we've got a skeleton, a warrior's bony corpse controlled by the power of darkness. It is brutal, but moves slowly. Movement, 6 squares. Attack, 2. Defend, 2. 1 body point. mind point zero, as all undead monsters have zero body points. So that makes them especially vulnerable to Holy Flame, which is cool, because they can't defend against it. And you get 10 gold for killing a skeleton, for re-killing a skeleton. Zombie. Like the skeleton, this corpse was revived by the power of dark magic. It still has rotten muscles and blood. Ew. It always carries a cleaver with him. I think one of the translations it said carries a machete with him. It kind of does look like a machete. But yeah, it's a cleaver, or huge axe of some kind. So you get 20 gold for killing a zombie. Now, in this one, the zombie only moves 4 squares, so he's slower. 2 attack, 3 defend, 1 body, 0 mind. But I think that was typical. Some of the monsters had fewer squares of movement in the European version versus North American. They really tweaked the monsters in the US version. Mummy, a corpse that has been preserved so that it will not rot in the darkness. It is driven with more powerful magic than skeletons and zombies. It is dangerous in single-handed fights. Movement 4 squares, 3 attack, 4 defense, 1 body point, 0 mind points. A reward 50 gold. So the mummy is weaker in this version. And then we've got, okay, so here's the 2 body point monsters. You got the Dark Warrior, which would be the Chaos Warrior, and the new version, the Dread Warrior, and the Gargoyle. So those are the only 2 that have 2 body points in this version. And it says, note, CD means combat die or dice. Yeah, I knew that. Okay. Dark Warrior, a warrior who succumbed to the power of darkness. He is dressed in armor and wields a cursed weapon. He has great physical strength, so it is difficult to defeat him. And I like, you know, the little interesting ways that, you know, because you take an English game, you translate it to Japanese, then you translate it back to English, and this is what it sounds like. But I like the kind of unique word choices. It's, it gives it a different charm and flavor. So, yeah. So he has 6 squares of movement, so I think that's 1 less than the North American version where he had 7. 3 attack dice, 4 defense dice, 2 body points, 3 mind points, 100 gold for killing the Dark Warrior. Yeah, the North American Chaos Warrior, he had 7 squares of movement, 4 attack dice, and 3 body points. So you can see the difference there. And then finally, the last monster in the list here is the Gargoyle. A monster made by giving life to a stone statue of a terrifying monster with the magic of darkness. It is very difficult to scratch its stone skin in combat. Movement 6 squares, attack 4 combat dice, defense 4 combat dice, 2 body points, 4 mind points. Reward 150 gold. So there you can see, the North American version, it had 5 defense and 3 body points. So you can see the difference there. Oh yeah, and then the last page, I love the fact that that was translated as well. It says, to customer who purchase, thank you for purchasing our product. If you have any questions about the product, sorry to trouble you, but please contact the customer service center. Takara Customer Service Center, and no guarantee that those phone lines are still active. But yeah, some nostalgia for you. And of course, Milton Bradley is responsible for this game in conjunction with Games Workshop. This is a fair use review here. And so the original people, once again, who worked on the translation from 2013 to 2016, or you could say 2012 to 2016, RNB, AERYNB, Bob, Blue Sun, Fenrir 79, and Jackie X. And actually, there is a Jackie X on Yielden that I thought maybe was one of these translators, but it's a different Jackie X. So if you see that person, that may not be the same one. And then, of course, Hispazargon did this particular interpretation. I like how he went through and he tried to match the artwork from a scan with the translated text. So again, unofficial fan translation. So I'd like to play through the rest of this. I think I've gotten to, let's see, my gaming group, because we haven't played in a long time. COVID kind of threw off a lot of our plans. Because we've played over Zoom before, but it does take a lot more time and effort to do that, especially if you don't have a nice webcam set up, because you got to get your game out and point the cameras and everything. A lot of times it would just be me doing the stuff, and then everybody else just has a character sheet or maybe roll some dice. But some people don't even like to play if they don't have the full experience, the full board and everything. So, plus it takes longer because you got to, confirm. It's like, okay, which square is your guy on now? Make sure everybody's set up to synchronize. But, it gets the job done. So yeah, I played up through Quest 4. Yeah, I think we just did the first four quests. And we were playing under North American rules, so we weren't doing all the gold and special magic and everything. Okay, I'm just going to read a little bit from the abstract. So this is Hispazargon's words here. This document is a direct translation to UK English language of the original 1991 HeroQuest Japanese Edition Questbook. The only aim of this work is helping to preserve the information contained in the original document for all past, today, and future generations of HeroQuest players. And I must say thank you. Please note, this is not an official translation, but its content tries to be as much accurate as possible to the original version. So, this means that despite of including some minor corrections of blatant errata detected in the original Japanese text, it has not been included modifications to the Japanese original quests or nor adaptation of them or their lore to the quests of other existing official editions of HeroQuest. Additionally, this also means that there are several terms of the game that this version names in a different way than the European and North American editions of HeroQuest do. But it has been intentionally written in such way in order to preserve as much as possible the charm and context of the original Japanese version. Some examples of those used terms are Demon King instead of Evil Wizard, Evil God instead of Chaos Warrior or Chaos Warlock, Dark Warrior instead of Chaos Warrior, or I'm sorry, yeah, Chaos Sorcerer or Warlock instead of, yeah, Evil God instead of that, Mono Lizard instead of Fimmer, Warrior instead of Barbarian, Magician instead of Wizard, and Grim Dead instead of Morcar or Zargon. Additionally, due to similar reasons, this version mentions terms like Varag, Balor, or Talisman of Lore that do not refer to the terms with the same name of European and North American version editions of HeroQuest. Sorry, as you can imagine, I don't think English is his first language either, but he's doing his best. So yeah, so in the Japanese version, the Talisman of Lore, yeah, it's a completely different thing. It allows you to revive the hero that's wearing it, like if he dies. So it's kind of like an elixir of life that kicks in if he gets killed. So that's the only other way that you can come back. Because in the North American version, if you had a potion of healing or a unused healing spell and you hadn't used an action yet on your turn, when you die, you just immediately come back with those body points restored. In the other versions, you better heal before you die. But in this version, if you've got the Talisman of Lore, some people retranslate it as the Talisman of Life or the Amulet of Life or something like that, just to differentiate it from the Talisman of Lore that gives you a mind point bonus in the other versions. But yeah, it lets you come back if you're wearing it when you go to zero body points. The other thing it can do in this version is that the Talisman of Lore can bring back a group of heroes. So if you get that situation where you get a total party kill, let's say the magician is running around and he's wearing the Talisman of Lore and he's the last one left and he gets iced, he could activate the artifact and bring back the whole party. So that's something you could do with your full body points restored. And whether or not they lose their gold, I forget. I'd have to look at the translation of the card. And again, the cards are still being translated. So that's that. So anyway, those are the things I want to talk about in this stream. Let me just double check if there's anybody around. I don't want to cut anybody off, of course. Oops. Sorry about that. Yeah, so don't have to worry. So I'm going to start another stream because I want to talk about some other stuff. but I don't want to get too far off track. So if you for the replay, it'll be a little more organized. So in the next stream, I'm going to be talking about the original version of HeroQuest, 1989 rulebook. And I'm also going to be talking about some custom stuff that I've done. Some I haven't done a ton of painting for this, but I did want to go over some stuff that I'd created through the help of other sources, of course, to get the materials. But then, yeah, so we'll do that in the next video. So thanks for watching. Thanks for listening. Thanks for tuning in to HeroQuest fans. And we'll be back shortly to do another video. Take care.